shed's on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Not a shadow can rise,
not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but his smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear, can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus to trust and obey.
We never can prove, but
we never can prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor he shows and the joy he bestows are for those who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet, or we'll walk by his side in the way. What he says we will do, where he sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
I will trust and obey.
Trust and obey. I will trust and obey.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. And my chains are gone,
you've done, the grace that you've poured out on us above measure, the love that you've lavished upon us, the patience you've shown us, the guidance you give us, the future you've promised us, Lord, all of these things cause us to humble ourselves before you, to recognize that not only are you far beyond our finding out, but the fact that you've made yourself known to us just breaks us down, Lord. We thank you for that. And we pray that as we spend our time together, continuing in fellowship and in your word, that that sense of those elements of worship, those things that bring us to that place of intimacy with you, wouldn't diminish because we stopped singing, but rather would carry right on into as we open your word, longing to hear your voice as we listen and are led by the Holy Spirit. So thank you for this time, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Amen, church. Won't you stand with me? Let's declare his goodness together. Psalm 145, verses 8 through 9. Won't you read with me? Verse 8 says, "The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and great in mercy. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies over all his works." Amen. Say hello to each other this morning.
How can Jesus Christ today?
I don't think so. We'll hang out together.
Good morning. Well, good morning again. Good to see y'all this morning. All right. How do you like this fall weather? Love it. Love it. Hey, let me share a few announcements as we settle in here. And if you got your bulletins, it's a good place to find out what's happening, as well as our website. We encourage you to sign up for our Facebook page, or at least check it out periodically. If you're not currently on our emailing list, just let us know if you'd like to be on it. Just jot your email name and email address down and stick it in our offering box, and we'll make sure we get you on there for our weekly emails. We also send out periodically some prayer requests as things come up, and also we'll share some stuff like what we're going to share right now as far as what's happening. Women's prayer, I believe, is going to meet this Tuesday. Is that correct? This Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock, Tuesday morning the 11th at 10 o'clock. That'll be at our house. Julie will be hosting that. Wednesday, we're going to continue our midweek fellowship in the book of Romans. So go ahead and start reading in chapter 13, if you will. And we're going to pick up there. It's never too late to join in. If you're looking to be part of that group, we'd love to have you come on out to the Martinez House, just right outside of downtown Franklin in West Haven. And is a haven directly to the west of downtown Franklin. It is literally that. So, our weekly outreach at NHC, we have moved the time to 1:30. It's at 1:30. That's used to be at 2:30. We've moved it up an hour. And then on the third Sunday of each month, Perry goes on over to the nursing home as well and does their Sunday church service there. So if you'd like to plug into any part of that outreach on Thursdays, Sundays, or if you'd like to maybe know just how to pray for that, just let us know. You can talk to Randy or Perry, myself, we are at Alonzo, and we can just kind of fill you in on how to plug in and certainly how to pray. Friday, this coming Friday, the 14th, we're going to have our movie night. That is going to be the end of the spear. It is the story of the Oak of Five. Of course, you've heard Jim Elliot, Steve Saint, and such. This is a really, really moving film, and we're going to show it at Randy and Gracie's house on Friday night. And we're going to show the movie at 6:30. I will ask if you would RSVP if you're going to come. You don't have to let us know if you're not coming, but please do let us know if you are coming, because we are going to get some pizza and we want to make sure we have some chairs set up and all that. It'll help us sort of get a sense of how we should get that organized. So you're all welcome to come, and just let us know that you are, if you don't mind. So, and if you'd like to bring like Cokes or brownies or something, feel free to do that as well. We're not going to have a sign-up sheet or anything. Just bring stuff if you like. And then Saturday, coming up on the 22nd, is going to be our next men's monthly prayer. We meet at the, actually, we're going to meet at Shoney's this time on 96. in South Franklin, right off the highway on 96. So guys, come on out for that. That's going to be at 8 o'clock in the morning on Saturday the 22nd. The next Women's Fellowship is on October 28th, and we don't have a time in the bulletin, but Janet mentioned that it's going to be at 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock. This way, they live in a really, really rustic area, and you'll want to drive in the daylight if you can. So we're going to pump it to 6 o'clock, I think, in an effort just in case it starts getting dark. It won't be so bad for you to make that drive. It's a really, really pretty drive. You'll want to see it anyway. So, and then lastly, Operation Christmas Child. The O'Briens are not here today, but Becca is heading that up. So normally on Sundays, we'll see some supplies back there with the boxes, the labels, and that kind of a thing. And Becca mentioned last time as well that when you're packing your box, one thing that we want to just make let you know about is that you'll want to put a check for $7 in there to cover the shipping for where it's going to go. If you forget or something, you can go online and you can just donate shipping. I mean, lots of boxes show up without any shipping. It all gets covered, and we actually make a donation as well to help cover some of those things. But if you think of it or you want to take a note, go ahead and just put a check in there for $7, and that will cover the shipping to get it to where it's going. And it goes to all over the place. It's really a great, great outreach. So we'd love for you to participate. Before we open our Bibles this morning, I'd like to pray for Lisa Garces. Vince and Lisa have been coming for a little bit now, and as we mentioned a couple weeks ago, Lisa had surgery on her jaw some time ago, and apparently it wasn't done quite right, and so she's been going through some really chronic pain. And if you've ever had pain like that anywhere near your ear, you know it just everything just shuts down. It just gets hard to function. And so she deals with that a lot. So he texted me this morning to tell me they weren't going to make it because she's in one of those times right now. So I told him we'd pray for her. So would you just pray with me? Father, we want to bring Lisa before you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for Father, just for her and the fact that she presses on in spite of the pain. But we do pray that you would lift that pain from her, that Father, you would just heal her body and just allow her to be free of that. We know that it can wear you down. It can just affect you in so many ways, physically and emotionally, just dealing with these things on and on. So we just pray that, Lord, you would lift that, Father, and just free her from it, even as we're praying right now. Lord, we know you teach us lessons in difficult circumstances like that. So we do pray that she and Vince would learn whatever it is that you want them to through that. But at the same time, you invite us to pray in faith for healing. And so we do that right now, knowing that you are fully capable, and we pray that you would do that. So we commit her to you, Father, and we just ask you to touch her body right now and heal her in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you would just keep her in prayer too as well. On that note, let me mention too, Cheryl is also improving. Mark and Cheryl, I don't think are here this morning, but Cheryl is on the mend. She's doing better. It's just been a slow go at it after her surgery as well. So just keep her in prayer as well. All right. Well, let me invite you now, if you would, to open your Bibles to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. We have been making our way through these two letters, and we're now going to start 2 Thessalonians, but it's all part of one series through these two letters that we've been calling Living Within View of the Finish Line. I'm sorry, does anyone need a Bible? Randy's ready to hand one out if anyone needs one. Just raise your hand, we'll get it to you. Okay, thanks, Randy. Appreciate it, bro. Living Within View of the Finish Line. And 1 and 2 Thessalonians deal with a number of subjects that Paul had an opportunity to teach this group of believers in Thessalonica over a really brief period of time. Three Sabbaths, the book of Acts tells us, he spent teaching them before, shortly thereafter being forced to leave the area. And so a number of those things that he covered were things like the second coming, the rapture, the Antichrist, conditions at the end of time before Jesus returns, and also how to live in the context of knowing that day is coming. And that has been really what has been the impetus for the name of this series through these two books. And so with that in mind, we're going to jump into 2 Thessalonians here, starting in verse 1 of chapter 1. We're going to cover through verses 5 today, but I'm just going to read the first two verses as we open. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, peace to you, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Paul's second letter to the Thessalonians was written shortly after the first letter. Not a lot of time between them, meaning that 1 and 2 Thessalonians, somewhere in concert with the letter to the Galatians, are the earliest of Paul's writings. Paul likely wrote this letter also from Corinth like he did the first one. It's a very encouraging letter in many respects, but again, much like the first one. There's been some speculation that, based on some of the internal stuff with the books, that maybe 2 Thessalonians was actually 1 Thessalonians, and they've been flipped over time. We don't know. But in any case, they're written close together, and they cover, in some senses, much of the same material as we go through, and we'll see that. But the letter to the Thessalonians was written really for three reasons, primarily. You'll see three main ideas that Paul brings out of this. One of those is that he's writing to calm believers' spirits. They have been led to believe by some by word, claiming to have heard from the Holy Spirit, and it appears also they received a letter purporting to be from Paul, that the day of the Lord had come. And so that had affected the church in a number of different ways. One of those ways is that they were troubled. In chapter 2, verse 2, I believe, where Paul talks about them not being troubled in heart as though the day of the Lord had come, as though this word that you had received was true. It's not true yet. And so Paul explains that and talks about some of the things that will surround that time when it comes, so that they'll be able to recognize it and also recognize that they're not currently in it. Also, Paul encourages them because of the effect that it had on some. The other two prongs of that I would say that Paul is speaking to in this letter is, on the one hand, to encourage believers to continue to press on and to press into the Lord in the times they were living in the expectation that Jesus was coming. In other words, he's not here yet, but he is coming, so therefore live full on for him. Be committed, be intentional. And we'll see that theme come up throughout the book, as we did in 1 Thessalonians as well. The flip side of that is that because that idea of the Lord's coming having arrived, some had actually become somewhat idle. Some had become sort of busybodies and not stopped actually working and sort of feeling like, well, Jesus is here anyway, so let's just sit and wait, kind of a thing. And so Paul speaks to that as well in rather direct terms. And so as we go through the letter, you'll see these themes coming up, both to comfort them, to encourage them to press on and to walk faithfully with the Lord until he actually does come, and then also to encourage them away from idleness, to step away from the idea of just sitting around doing nothing, waiting for Jesus to come back, thinking, since he's right here, since we're about to see him any minute, let's just sit around and wait for that. That's not an attitude encouraged in the Christian life, and Paul will speak to that. So again, Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy. These three men both all have their names, I should say, as authors or contributors to this letter. Or at least they're all there with Paul, and they're with him when he writes this letter. Paul, of course, and forgive me if this seems a little basic to some of you, but in the case that some are not familiar enough with some of these things, I'd like to go through it and give some explanation as to who these people are. Paul, we first encounter in the New Testament as Saul of Tarsus. He is a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He is a legalist to the nth degree. He is somebody who had, at that time, had prided himself on upholding the law, or at least if he had broken it, he was very quick to rectify, very quick to do the offerings and such, very quick to do the proper things in response to those failures and that. He was somebody that other people would have their kids walk by, and when they would see Saul, they would say, that's the kind of guy you want to be like. Look how upright he is. Which is to say that, like the rest of the Pharisees and the rest of those who were in religious authority during Jesus' time, he was arrogant. He was cocky. He was somebody who relied on his own self-righteousness to have a right standing before God. That was our first encounter with who we know as Paul. And then one day on the road to Damascus, Jesus literally stops him on the road, blinds him, and speaks to him. And says, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It's difficult for you to kick against the goads. And Saul says, who are you, Lord? And Jesus responds to him, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. And Paul's response after that is to say, what would you have me do? And from that point on, Saul soon afterwards becomes known as Paul. It's interesting. Saul was his name as a Pharisee before he knew the Lord, and then he changes his name to Paul, which means little. That's significant. It's also interesting he doesn't, at this early stage in his ministry, he doesn't introduce himself as Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, though he is. He's handpicked by Paul, by the Lord. But he refers to himself simply as little. Not a man of stature, not a man of status. That may owe itself somewhat to the earliness of these writings in that. Paul at no point becomes arrogant later, and that's why he uses the title. But he rather embraces the responsibilities that God has given him to the point where he's comfortable referring to himself in that way. But at this early point, he doesn't even use that term yet. Just Paul. Now, Paul ultimately becomes the greatest evangelist the church has ever seen, church planner, missionary, somebody who is busy about the Lord's work constantly throughout his life. He works tirelessly for the Lord, which makes me wish I was one of those guys like Silvanus or Timothy. What would it have been like to be with somebody like that? I like to think I work hard for the Lord, but when I read what Paul did, and I read where he went, and I read what kind of fervor he brought to his ministry, I really admire that. I look at that and I think, wow, what would it have been like to sort of be a protege of such a man? Well, Silvanus, or Silas as we better know him in the New Testament, and Timothy were two such men who had that opportunity, as well as others, but they're with him at this time. Silvanus, again, is Silas. We see him in Acts 15 show up on the scene. He's one of those who was around during the time of the first church council in Acts chapter 15. He's one of those who brought the decision of that council out to the surrounding churches. He became Paul's traveling companion after Paul splits with Barnabas over John Mark. If you're not familiar with that, there was some tension between Paul and Barnabas, and they divided over John Mark, Barnabas' relative, his cousin, because John Mark had departed from Paul on an earlier missionary journey. When it came time to go again, Barnabas wanted him to come with, but Paul said no, and they fought over this. They argued over this until finally they divided over it. And Silas became one of those who went with Paul as John Mark went with Barnabas. And so Silas is one then. He's also known as a prophet in Acts 15. We see him in jail with Paul in the Philippian jail. He's somebody who is actively involved in the ministry of Paul and propagating the gospel, church planting, and we see him here in Corinth alongside of Paul when this letter is written. And Timothy, likewise, is somebody who Paul considers very dear to him. Matter of fact, he's called a son in the faith in 1 Timothy, which may owe itself to the fact that Paul was involved in Timothy's conversion, or at the very least, he certainly took him under his wing enough to where he became a very, very dear protege, and even to the point of being called a son. He joins Paul's missionary party right after that time when Paul and Silas come together, and ultimately he travels with them. He's the one who brought news of the Thessalonian church's condition. We read about that in 1 Thessalonians. When they could stand it no more, they sent Timothy to find out how the church was doing, because Paul had to leave under cover of night very suddenly. And after he left, he understood that the church would be persecuted. And as time had gone by, he couldn't get back to them. And so he sent Timothy to find out how they were doing. It was very blessed to hear that they were doing well. And we read about that in 1 Thessalonians. We'll read more about it in 2. Well, Timothy also, as we can tell, oversaw the work in Ephesus for a time. His mom, his grandmother were Jewish in that. His father was a Greek, which means he was influenced by a lot of different influences. He had dual heritage, if you will. He was not solely Jewish. He was not solely Greek. He actually had parentage on both sides of that, which, as you might imagine, would come in handy. We've often said to our daughter, who has Russian citizenship for another 5 years alongside of her American citizenship, as we adopted her from Russia, that should she decide to go and be a missionary, she could renew that. Or if she goes even before she's 18, she could enter the country of Russia legally with her passport. She's a citizen. So things like that come in handy. With Paul, we see it come in handy on a number of occasions throughout his ministry. Well, Timothy also shares some of that same benefit. Now, they're writing this letter to the church of Thessalonica, okay? Thessalonica is a large city. Even at that time, it was 200,000 people. It's a port city, which, again, is significant. Port cities at that time, and typically in the old, in olden times, in ancient times, you would always build towns and cities close to a water supply for obvious reasons. They didn't have plumbing like we do. The Romans had their aqueducts, which was amazing, and they could carry water from long distances and just... It's an amazing architectural feat, but most places didn't have that kind of access. So typically, and all the way up until that time, you would typically build your towns close to water. Thessalonica was one of those towns that was built near the water, and as such, it was a port city, which meant commerce took place there, which meant people from every walk of life, every kind of culture, every religious and cultural background would meet in such a place, along with other port types of cities, and they would bring with them their influences. Now, in our day, you don't have to live near a port to be influenced in that. You could just, we have airports. We have travel from city to city very conveniently. We have electronics that we can communicate with people. I could pull out my phone right now and have a video chat with somebody on the other side of the world right now.
So we don't have to be on a port city, but I say all that to say this. The people of that town and the church that had been established in that town in Thessalonica were influenced or had the potential to be influenced by all kinds of cultures, by all kinds of religious views. It was a very multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-worldview kind of an environment, which on the one hand made it a difficult thing for a church to exist in, but on the other hand was exactly the reason why there ought to be a church there. Because not only does the world have influence bringing it into that place, but the church in that place has the potential now to be an influence going out to all of these same places that are bringing their influences in. I say that because that's important for us to understand, that the church exists not just to exist. The church exists to have influence. We are the body of Christ. Jesus was itinerant, wasn't he? Jesus went from place to place. Matter of fact, I wish I had thought of it earlier, but there's this wonderful piece that was written. I've seen it quoted in many places, but it's called One Solitary Life. Some of you have maybe read this or have heard it before, and I could pull it up on my phone, I guess, but just the basic writing revolves around the idea that here in this place in the Middle East, in a space of just 3.5 years, this person who had no, you know, he had nothing of his own that he owned except for the coat on his back. He never traveled around the world like so many great people that we think of have. He never wrote a book, per se. You know, he never sat down and penned a book, a novel, or some kind of a thing. All the things that we typically ascribe to greatness, he didn't have any of those kinds of things. Nevertheless, no one, matter of fact, everyone, all put together, who has ever had that kind of influence around the world has not had anywhere near the influence in this world like that one solitary life. In that short span of time, 3.5 years, of course, we understand the Lord, he's God in the flesh, but understand that walking among man for that short span of time, he began what became the Christian faith around the world. The massive amount of influence. Why? Because that's why he came. So that people would come and be saved. So that lives and eternities would be altered. So that people would not just learn lots of really neat stuff and not see some really cool things, but to be changed from the inside out. To deal with the biggest problem that mankind had, and that was to give the solution to our sin. The one thing that everybody tries to deal with in one way or another, but nobody can until him. And he went around preaching the kingdom of God is at hand, therefore repent. That's our job now. That's what we do. That's the kind of engagement we are to have with the world around us. And for this church in Thessalonica to exist right there is not an accident. It's extremely strategic. And you and I are where we are right now, strategically by God. He's put us here with a purpose in mind. And so when we meet, it's to understand and be equipped for that we might go. And that's why Paul is writing these letters to this church. That's why he is investing himself in them, that they might be strong and that they might have influence. And in the last letter, you might recall how Paul commended them for that very thing, that all the surrounding areas had seen the impact of their walk with Christ. They had a positive impact on those around them because of their walk with Christ. And so we want to take something from that. We don't want to simply miss that fact. So again, this port city, a lot of influence going in, but the potential to put a lot of influence out as well. And again, as I mentioned earlier, Paul spent a very brief amount of time there, but covered a lot of very deep subjects in that city. So Paul goes on again. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy to the church of the Thessalonians in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. At the very outset, Paul reminds them that they are in God the Father and Christ. Okay, in. They are in union with, they are closely joined to God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. It's also probably not an enormous thing, but I will point out that when Paul introduces or greets them in the first letter, he doesn't say our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, you know, to the church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Here he says our. Small thing again, but slightly more intimate. He is our Father. He is our Lord. And we are in Him. We are closely connected to Him. We are in union with Him. That's what it means to be a follower of Jesus. Our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace, God's favor, His goodwill toward us. The same word that is spoken by the angel in Luke chapter 2. The idea of grace and peace. Peace, that idea of there being no animosity, that idea of there being no hostility between us, the fact that there is tranquility between you and I now, peace has been brought is what's implied there. Grace to you and peace. God's favor and the absence of turmoil in this relationship. Peace be with you. And it's always interestingly in that order. It's always in that order. When you read Paul's letters and he says grace and peace, it's never peace and grace. It's always grace and peace. Except when he's writing to Timothy, then he says grace, mercy, and peace. Pastors need that mercy. But grace and peace, always in that order. Why? Because peace with God always comes through the grace of God. So grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now we'll read verses 3-5. We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is fitting or as it's appropriate, because your faith grows exceedingly, and the love of every one of you all abounds toward each other, so that we ourselves boast of you among the churches of God for your patience and faith in all your persecutions and tribulations that you endure, which is manifest evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you also suffer. So Paul, Silas, and Timothy, to start off the letter, they are thankful for, and they also boast about, these young believers. From their perspective, the believers in Thessalonica, that's encouraging. I mean, Paul encourages them right off the bat. We are so thankful for you. And that word thankful there speaks of being like you feel like you owe a debt. You're thankful like that. And they feel as though, Paul, Silas, and Timothy feel as though they owe God a debt. Why? Because in the earlier letter, and we'll also see it later in this one too, they're praying for them. They are praying that they would be this very thing. And God has shown himself faithful on behalf of the Thessalonians, and that they are. They are strong in their faith. They are growing. Their love for one another is increasing. Paul has prayed for some of these things specifically. And God, he feels he owes God a debt for being faithful to them and answering that prayer. Well, how encouraging for the believers in Thessalonica to hear that. Not only that Paul has been praying for them, but Paul has also found out that they are being all of those things. They're growing. They're strong. They're healthy. Even more impressive in the fact that they only had a short amount of time invested in them and Paul physically being with them. But they took hold of it and they ran with it and they stood on it. And Paul commends them for this. And he says, we owe God a great debt for what he is doing in you right now. We're bound to thank God always for you as it's fitting, because your faith grows exceedingly and the love of every one of you abounds toward each other. And also he speaks then of the fact that not only is their faith and their love increasing and abounding, but also they're remaining steadfast and faithful in the midst of their persecutions. So let's look at those for 1 minute. Their faith is growing. Their faith. The idea of faith speaks of trust, confidence that is unwavering. Faith, I forget if I've shared this in here before, but years ago, Julie and I made a very failed attempt at trying to lead a youth group. And I'd say the failure was on my part. Julie's actually really good with young people. I'm terrible leading a youth group. You ought to be thankful Justin's around, because I'm, and Tara, I just, ugh. But I could tell you stories. But anyway, so there was one of the first youth group meetings we did, we taught on this lesson of faith, the idea of trust. And the exercise we did for this, and just by way of example, suppose I had Ryder come up here and I had, we'll say Haley come up or something. I won't make you do it, but suppose I did that. And I said, Ryder, I want you to stand right here. And Haley, I want you to stand right here. Maybe you can see where I'm going with this. They do this in business, trust exercises. Now, Ryder, I want you to fall back and Haley will catch you. First off, nobody really thinks that's going to happen, right? Well, I had two kids of about that size do that. And now they both looked at me like I was crazy. And I knew they weren't going to do it because I knew they'd both be scared. So, and of course, when they didn't, I said, well, okay, obviously I don't really want you to do that because you'll crush her. So I got behind, this kid's name was Eddie. I said, okay, Eddie, Now, fall back and I'll catch you. Now, I was as big as Eddie, okay? Eddie had no problem falling back now because he knows I will catch him because I can. He had faith in my ability to catch him. That's the idea, okay? When we're talking about faith, in terms of our faith in God, we're talking about confidence in his ability to do that which he says he will do. His ability to be there all the time. His ability to catch me when I fall. His ability to keep me from falling through the cracks. His ability to supply for my needs. His ability to keep the air coming so I don't die. His ability to do all the things that I can't do myself. And his ability to give me the ability to do things in the first place. Trust in those things. That's confidence. Faith is not just some mystical thing out there that we sort of try to put our spiritual buckets out there and pull some in so I can have faith. That's kind of what the televangelist would lead you to believe, that faith is something you muster up and you build up and you get enough of it, and of course all the sowing your seeds that goes with it to demonstrate and all this craziness. That's not faith. That's not what faith is. Faith is not how hard can you believe something. How many of you ever saw the Indiana Jones movies? They were great movies, weren't they? Well, there was, I think it was the third one where Sean Connery was in it as his dad. And there's a point where he's after the Holy Grail, and he goes, and he comes to a precipice, and he needs to cross it. And he's thinking through the puzzle that he's sort of figuring out how to get there. And the one thing talks about having faith. And so faith for him means he needs to sort of step out against all reason, step out into this precipice to make his walk across. Well, of course, then he takes that step and what is he doing? He's exhibiting faith. And he steps on this thing and it catches him. There's like this invisible bridge that goes across. So, but, you know, faith isn't just blindly running out in some direction that's stupid. That's a chasm, dude. That's crazy. You don't just step out on the air unless God told you to step out on the air. And there was no indication that Indiana Jones was following God or anything like that. Whatever. But it's just, but faith is not something like that. Faith is something that we have because of what God has given us that causes us to trust him. You know, he has done enough for us to hang our hats on, where when we finally come to something that requires us to simply trust him, it becomes a very reasonable thing to do. He may ask us to do things that are outside of our skill set, outside of our capacity, outside of a choice that we might have made. But it's only because he has built us into a place of trusting him enough to do it. Okay, that's important for us to recognize. We're not talking about blind leaps of faith. We are talking about trust and confidence in somebody. This is the language of relationship. This is not some force that we're manipulating. This is relationship with a person. When Nina was learning to walk, we could hold our arms out, and when she would walk to us, she knew we would catch her. She exhibited faith because she saw that mommy and daddy, they've got me. That's what we're talking about, okay? So their faith is growing, which means what? They are learning to build confidence in God. Not in self, in God. They are learning to trust him as they are walking through their Christian life in the midst of heavy persecution, and they are seeing God demonstrate faithfulness, and they are having their faith built upon such things. They are seeing God provide for them in their difficulties. They are seeing God bring new people to faith in their midst. They are seeing God allow them to have opportunity for their faith to be demonstrated in ways that the world around them is hearing about it. Okay? Their faith is growing. And the idea of growing exceedingly means growing to an extreme limit. Their faith is growing fully, is the idea. They are a healthy, strong church, and it's based on the fact that they are learning to grow in confidence with God. Let me also make this point. It's their faith that Paul refers to it as. Their faith. Okay? Every Christian owns his own faith. Let me explain what I mean by that. Faith comes from God. We get that. Faith is rooted in God. We understand that. We've just been talking about building confidence in God. But every Christian is responsible to cultivate their own relationship with God that their faith might grow. In other words, you might see something God is doing in someone else's life and be encouraged by that to take steps out and learn to trust God in those ways, but ultimately you need to be the one to take that step to have your faith grow. It's one thing to see, and we all probably have heroes that have done great things for the Lord that we could think of right now. And we look at them and we think, wow, that's awesome. Just the faith it took to take a step and to do something like that. Well, that's true, but that's their faith. What happens when it's my turn to step out? Am I going to do that? That's my responsibility now. It's not riding on someone else's coattails. I can be encouraged by that. I heard it this way. It was on a similar kind of a subject, but one of the pastor's conferences a couple years ago, one of the guys, and a younger guy too, I mean, he's probably a little bit younger than I am, and I'm pretty young. But one of the younger guys coming up, pastors and that, he had, you know, a lot of us, and if you didn't come from a Calvary Chapel, some of these, you know, I could, this might be less familiar to you than it would be for people that maybe are used to going to Calvary's now, but a lot of us as pastors have always really been encouraged and blessed by some of the stories we would hear about Pastor Chuck years ago. And of course, he's passed on now. We just passed the anniversary of his death. But we used to love hearing the stories about, you know, what God did in the early days of Calvary Chapel. We used to love hearing how, you know, how the Holy Spirit would just show up in these meetings and you'd see hundreds of kids get saved. And you'd see these people take these steps of faith out somewhere. And God would just bless that simple innocence that they had to trust him as they took various steps out. And we're always encouraged by that. And it blesses our hearts to hear that about him and about them in that era. But this pastor, as he was reminding us of some of these things, he said, you know what? I want my own stories. I don't want to have to just look back all the time on what God did then. I want to be able to talk about what God's doing now. And God is doing things now. But it then befalls us to say, are we going to take a step of faith when God has led us to that point of taking one? Some of you may be wrestling with those things right now. I know that God has led me to a place in my life. The circumstances have come together. God is, you know, there are things in Scripture that have just really spoken to me about my circumstances, but I don't know if I want to take that step. Don't always be afraid to do that. I mean, again, God's not asking you to do something stupid. And if he wants you to do something that really is pushing you, he'll confirm that to you. Things will come about that will allow that to become a very reasonable next step for you. But don't be afraid to. Don't be afraid to. You and I need to have our own stories. You and I need to have our own stories. But their faith was growing, and it was growing exceedingly. Not only that, but their love for one another was abounding. The love of every one of you all abounds toward each other. Now, we know Paul's actually not a Southerner because that would have been the faith of all y'all. But the faith of you all is abounding to one another. That word there, as you might imagine, is that word agape, that Christ-like kind of love, that selfless, sacrificial kind of love. But their love for one another, in other words, their love as a body of believers, was increasing toward one another. It was abounding. It was full and fruitful toward each other. Their love for one another was, again, a direct answer to Paul's prayer in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, where he prayed that that very thing would happen, and he got word that it was. And he was encouraged, and they must have been encouraged through it. But I want to point this out about their love for one another. It's one thing to say that you love somebody. It's another thing to demonstrate your love. The story is told of the elderly couple sitting on their chairs in their living room after 60 years of marriage. And they've been sitting on these easy chairs night after night watching Archie Bunker reruns for years and years and years. Until one day, the wife turns to her husband and says, "You know what, honey, I got to ask you something." "What is it, dear?" "Well, why is it you never tell me you love me anymore?" He thought about it for a minute. He said, "Well, you know, I told you I loved you on the day we got married. If anything changes, I'll let you know." Of course, that's crazy. The wife would not be satisfied with that answer, right? Flip the same coin over for a second, and let me mention to you that you don't see in the Gospels where Jesus looks at each of the disciples or any of the disciples and says, "I love you." That's conspicuously absent from the Gospels. Nevertheless, in John 13, John 15, he's able to talk about how he has loved them, okay? In John chapter 13, as he's about to gird his waist and wash their feet, just an extremely short period of time before he's about to be arrested, he girds up this thing, but it says, as he's about to wash their feet, it mentions how, and this is John recording it, how Jesus loved them, the disciples, to the very end. Now, you don't see anywhere in the Gospels where Jesus says, "John, I love you." But John knows that Jesus loved him. because it was demonstrated. There was no, they didn't have to ask about it because they knew it. Love was demonstrated physically and practically to where they understood it. They had been loved of the Lord. It's important that love not only be spoken of, but that it be demonstrated. It be demonstrated in patience toward one another, or in deference to one another, preferring one another over ourselves, in treating each other with respect, in avoiding self-seeking and sacrificial kinds of actions, in thinking well of others instead of evil. Love is something that is demonstrated, something that is lived out, something. Love is one of those things that's better felt than telt. You know what I mean? It's like there's just something about, you know, if somebody loves you. And you can tell when somebody doesn't. And you don't even need to have words necessarily. You can tell, because that's the nature of love. It was a very easy thing, I imagine, for Paul to write 1 Corinthians 13, some of which I sort of borrowed from in the list I just gave. But the idea of what love is, well, when you look at what love is, you actually look at that list and realize that love isn't just is, love does. Love is a verb. Love outreaches. Love acts. Love responds. Love gets involved in. We talked last time, or I should say it was Wednesday night in our study in Romans, the idea of that, of the church getting involved in each other's lives in a meaningful way and not isolating or insulating ourselves from one another. Why? Because that's not the nature of love. Love wants to give. Love wants to do. Love wants to pick up the pieces when they fall apart in your life. Love wants to be there to hear when you've got something going on. Love wants to be there to help meet your need when you're in need. That's what love does by nature. That's what was growing in their church. Now, we've said this many times. It shouldn't surprise us to hear it again. But in the first century, the believers of that church in that time, not just Thessalonica, but the church at that time, was often a group of believers, and almost always a group of believers, that had been ostracized from every other pocket of society. Whether family, whether friends, whether employment, whatever it was. Because you were now following a cult leader. You were following somebody who dared not to bow their knee to Caesar. And because you followed this Jesus, you wouldn't bow your knee to Caesar anymore either. Which immediately set you at odds with Rome, which immediately made you toxic. You're not going to work for me. Why? Because some soldiers may show up here one day and decide to tell me that you're an affront to Rome. I'm not going to hire somebody like that. So what happened? As a result of that kind of thing, the church became very close-knit because they all were basically in the same boat. Some may have had more resources than another, but they all were in need of each other. And so when they would have their love feast, they would provide for each other. When there was needs, they'd bring them to the disciples in those early days, and they would distribute it as there was need. Paul speaks to the idea that in Corinth, in their love feast, one of the affronts to their Christian faith was that they mistreated the poor in their love feasts. Because that shouldn't be. Why? Because the body should be there for each other. We should love each other. Well, in that church, that was happening. Their love for one another was abounding. It was explosive. It's the kind of thing that people noticed. And Jesus did say, after all, didn't he, that how will the world know you're my disciples? By your love for one another. This is, oftentimes we're, and maybe it's just I'm afraid of this, but, there's no way to say this without sounding mean. I don't mean it to be, but a lot of times nowadays we hear a lot of syrupy sermons, don't we? Love becomes so sort of, doesn't have any teeth. Love is just the feeling we have toward each other, so we treat each other a certain way, for the most part, because we ought to love one another. Well, we ought to treat each other very kindly, in genuine love for one another, but love has teeth. Love has grit. Love will love even when it doesn't get loved back. Love will love because that's what God has put in us. Love is ferocious. Love's not content to sit by idly and watch somebody suffer. Love is not going to let somebody go to hell because we're afraid of offending them. Love's not going to let your child dabble in all the different things they can dabble in because, after all, you just want to fit in with their kids at school. No, love's going to keep you from shooting yourself in the head with all this stuff that's floating around. Love's going to get involved in your life, And the truth is, when I came to Christ because some people had no reason to love me. You know, that's why I'm saved today. Two of them are sitting right here. They had no reason to love me, but they did. Love drove them to not leave me alone. And that's why I'm here today. Okay, that's what was existing in the church in the first century there. So when we talk about love, we're talking about all the beautiful things that it makes us feel, but it's so much more than that. And the reason we can feel it so moving, in such a moving way, is because it is so much more than that. You know, it's like you wouldn't give your wife or your husband a gift one day a year on your anniversary and then blow them off the other 364 days. Because that one gift wouldn't mean anything. That's not love. That's a trip to Penny's or something. That's you maybe not feeling, trying to keep yourself from feeling guilty about something. Love is something that's actively involved in pursuing each other all year, right? I mean, love does that. Why? Because love does. Have I said enough about that? Do you get love does? Okay, you good? Okay, I'm gonna move on. So their love abounded toward each other. And then lastly, in terms of what Paul is commending them for, he goes on in verse 4, he says, so that we ourselves boast of you among the churches of God for your patience and faith in all your persecutions and tribulations which you endure. Okay? So they remain steadfast and faithful in the face of persecution. Steadfast there, the idea of how they had patience or long-suffering, steadfastness is the idea here. That word speaks of a capacity to endure under difficult circumstances. It presses on when things are hard. Okay, it doesn't get pushed back because an obstacle is in the way. It pushes through the obstacle. It holds on when there's something pulling down. You will stay holding on to this thing with tenacity until you get this thing done. That's the kind of word this is. They were steadfast, and again, there's that word faith again. When he talks there about their faith, it's again that confidence in God. So what Paul is saying is, I'm commending you because you have remained faithful, tenaciously faithful in the midst of the pressures and afflictions that have come upon you. That's saying something. And we'll talk more about it in a moment, but that is a demonstration of a solid believer that can stand in the face of persecution. A lot of times when difficult things come our way, it becomes easy to sort of back off of the idea of staying steadfast in our faith or in some area of our faith. It's sometimes we make the mistake of adopting a when in Rome, do what the Romans do. Why? Because it's easier. Well, as Christians, we live in Rome 24/7, but we're never called to do as the Romans do whenever it potentially causes us to be an offense to the Lord. Yes, we're to be all things to all men, but we're not supposed to just sin. You know what I mean? There's a point at which we stop and say conviction must prevail here. A line is drawn here. That's what it means to be steadfast. I will not move this line. This is as far as it goes. They were able to do that. And Paul said, I commend you for that. Your faith has stood. I like what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 16 when he talks to believers in Corinth, who again, he is speaking to as a group of people who by and large are quite carnal as a group of believers. He's been writing most of 1 Corinthians to correct errors and problems and sins in the church. But when he gets toward the very end of the book, he tells them, be watchful, stand fast in the faith, be brave, be strong. And I think the ESV even says something like, you know, set yourself up like a man or something to that effect, you know? But it's the idea of be strong, stand firm, do not bend, do not waver. Okay? Those are good admonitions. Those are good admonitions for Christians. And they sound like great guy admonitions, but they're good men and women admonitions. All of us as believers have been given an opportunity to put a line in the sand for Jesus and not move any further from that point. And Paul says, good for you guys. We even boast about you among the other churches because this is the kind of quality of believer you have grown into. And Paul here, as we kind of begin to wrap this into verse 5 and begin to wrap it up, Paul talks about their faith in terms of what it means, what it demonstrates. Again, we talk about faith. There's an expression, faith that hasn't been tested can't be trusted. And I like that. Of course, you can find faults in any pithy little sayings and stuff, but I like that. Faith that hasn't been tested can't necessarily be trusted. In other words, if your faith has never been challenged, how do you know if it can withstand the challenges when they become heavy? Because everyone will face difficulty. Paul told Timothy as a young pastor, all who seek to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. Okay? Now, we don't quote that promise a lot. If we're going to name and claim stuff, that one normally doesn't make the list. But it's a promise nonetheless. It's a promise nonetheless. If you and I are going to walk with Jesus intentionally, then we are going to face some pushback on that. In our culture, that's not a big deal. We might get made fun of or something, or we might not get the promotion or some kind of a thing. But when you think of people like the Hall of Faith in Hebrews chapter 11, or when you think of Job, who didn't have the benefits of Job 1 and 2, still stood strong with the Lord. He had his questions, he had his wonderings why this is and all that, but he also had the influence of all of his friends telling him that he must have done something wrong. He didn't know what was going on, but through it all, he was able to maintain his trust in the Lord. What about Asaph in Psalm 73? Why do the wicked prosper, but the good always seem to suffer? Well, I went to the house of the Lord, and there I found my answer, and I saw their end. In other words, he went to the right place that he might not falter and fail in his faith, but rather he went to the Lord that he might understand some aspect of that. What about Habakkuk? God, why is there so much evil among your people and you don't seem to do anything about it? Well, Habakkuk, here's what I'm going to do about it. What? How could you do that? Talk about, I don't understand God. What, you know, people say, I don't understand God. God literally spoke to him in that circumstance, and Habakkuk's like, what? How could you possibly work that way? We're bad, but the nation you want to bring in to judge us is worse. That was his conundrum. That was his problem with faith. But nevertheless, at the end of it all, he said, like hinds feet, I'm going to, you know, like the deer on hinds feet in that. He sings this wonderful song of praise saying, you're the Lord. I will trust your judgment on this. Abraham, when bartering for Sodom and Gomorrah, he can ask the question rhetorically because everybody, especially Abraham, knows the answer. When God is going to bring judgment upon Sodom and Gomorrah, and Abraham begins to barter, what if there's 100 righteous? What if there's 90, 80, 70, 60, 50, 40, 30, 20, 10? What if there's 10? Will not the judge of all the earth do what's right? It's rhetorical because the answer is obviously yes. Why? Because he trusts God. He has confidence in the goodness of God. You could talk about George Mueller, who trusted God in his goodness and his willingness to provide and would start, 8 orphanages over the course of his ministry. Never told anybody what he needed. Simply brought it to the Lord, and God answered those needs time and time again. What about Hudson Taylor? Same thing. Just learning to trust God on the mission field in China. You could go on and on and on about people who have learned to trust God and to be able to stand firm regardless of what came against them, the opposition. How many of us would have packed up and gone home in China if we had faced the opposition that a Hudson Taylor faced? I'd probably be one of them. I'm not pointing fingers. Don't get me wrong. But God often calls us to rest, not on his explanations, but on promises. Not that explanations aren't important, but at the end of the day, when we find ourselves struggling with a difficulty, you know, I hate to use trite, cliche terms, but a crisis of your faith where you are really questioning the goodness or faithfulness of God, I can sit down here and give you a wonderful apologetic answer on why you should trust God and all the ins and outs. Let's talk about the various philosophical approaches to this. And what about the existential situation that you're in? Is that going to help you? It may help you understand some things. But at the end of the day, it's not that I explained away your problem. If you can't anchor your hope to the Lord personally, no answer is really going to solve that for you. Why? Because God hasn't called us to walk simply on explanations. He has called us to trust in his promises. And that takes confidence in him. And they remain steadfast in that regard. Now, as we look again at verse 5, he moves into this idea here. What is the purpose of these persecutions? They're growing in their faith. They're learning to trust God. They're learning to let their love grow for one for another and everything. But Paul here goes on and talks about their persecutions in verse, and I'll include verse 6 in this, even though we're going to look at it next time. Verse 5 again, this is manifest evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you also suffer, since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you. Now, don't misunderstand. When he talks about being worthy of the kingdom of God, he's not talking about you earning your place in the kingdom of God because you showed yourself faithful. Okay, you can't earn a place at the table. That's not something you and I can ever do something that guarantees that. However, trials will often demonstrate our worthiness. They don't necessarily provide an earning means of getting there, but they do demonstrate what God has worked out in us. We know we don't earn that. Paul says that in Ephesians 2. You know, it's saved by grace through faith, that not of myself, it's not of works, lest anyone should boast. But I want to bring this point out because I want us to understand that when trials come our way, when persecution comes our way, when difficulties or hardships come our way, we ought not be so quick to want to resist them. It's like the Warren Wiersbe talked about a woman who came to him one day when he was pastoring the Moody Church and talked about this tremendous trial that she was going in. And as any pastor would, Warren Wiersbe just began to pray for her that God would, say, I'll pray for you that God would lift this trial from you. And she said, well, Pastor Wiersbe, please do pray that, but also pray that I would have the wisdom to see what God is teaching me through it. You see, trials come our way not to break us down, although they might come to break us. They don't come to crush us to pieces and powder, but they do come to break us to the point of submitting to the will of God or learning to trust Him in a circumstance that requires that. As a matter of fact, I'm going to have you turn to a couple of passages here. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. We're just going to read a couple of verses here, and there's one other place as well. And I want to turn to these because when you face trials and situations like that, I want you to know where to look in the Word of God to gain some sense of comfort and understanding and peace in them. But notice here in just looking at verses 6 and 7 in chapter 1 of 1 Peter. Really, verses 3 through 9 would be a great thing to delve into in its own. But let's just look at verses 6 and 7. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, as I'll have you also turn to James. Just turn a book to your left. James chapter 1. And look at verses 2 through 4. And again, the whole chapter would be great to delve into, but just for our time's sake, let's look at a couple of verses for our point here. But James says, my brethren, verse 2, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Now, I already got a problem with that. Count it all joy when you enter into various trials. If you don't have a problem, you weren't listening to me. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience, but let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, or mature and complete, lacking nothing. Now, why turn to those passages? Because they give us insight into the value of trials and difficulties and hard circumstances. James talks about trials having the ability to cause our faith to be increased, our trust in God to be increased, and the fact that we're going through it, knowing that God is first off working a purpose in it. We all know Romans 8:28. You know, it's the idea that all things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to His purpose. The principle that underlies that finds application in our difficult times. We understand that God is there and He's a purpose in what He's bringing us through. And it's ultimately a good purpose. These things will test us and bring us to maturity in Christ. That's one of the things that trials and difficulties will do in us. They will bring us closer to maturity in Christ. Secondly, Peter, as we read, there's three words that jump out at me. Though you've been grieved by various trials, if need be. Those are three vital points of pivot for that passage. If need be. If you and I are going through a trial, a difficulty, a struggle, a time of persecution, understand that if you are walking with the Lord, this is not some response to you being in sin, or say you're walking with the Lord with conviction. You're not just being some obnoxious person. You are simply walking with the Lord. Your testimony is solid. You're not in sin, and you still find yourself in that place, in persecution, in hardship, in struggle, or in trial of some kind. Understand that it must of needs be. Okay? If it were not so, God would not need to put you there or me there. But there's a purpose in it. And it's only when we understand the nature and character of God that we can have the confidence, the faith, in knowing that He has us there for a reason. In other words, it's not a trite thing to tell people that there's a purpose why we go through these hardships. But man, someone close to me died. A child died, or a family member passed away, or a child is wayward, or some kind of a thing. I'm not saying that you brought this on yourself in some way, but there is some value in the fact that in your life right now, this is the experience that you are having. In other words, it's not wasted. It's not for nothing. It's not like this is just, hardship just happens and that's just how it is. Yes, it does happen. And in a sense, no one's going to avoid it. So in that sense, sure, that's how it goes. But a Christian understands, not just hopes, not just believes because we should. We know that God has a purpose in all of these things. He doesn't waste a moment of our lives. He is constantly building us and leading us towards something different, deeper, even, dare I say, better. That through testing, Peter says, speaking of refining, our faith might be proven and genuine. Okay? So internally, trials, difficulties have a purpose, but also externally. And Paul speaks to this idea here as well. He says in verse 6, it's a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you. Externally speaking, trials and persecutions in particular demonstrate the righteous judgment of God. Persecution makes clear and clearly visible those who are walking with God and those who are fighting against those who are walking with God, and by extension, fighting against God. In other words, when you and I are walking with the Lord and we face persecution, or if someone, we're at a Voice of the Martyrs conference yesterday, so we heard people talk about walking in the face of persecution for their faith. The fact that you're experiencing that allows God to demonstrate with absolute clarity his righteousness in judging those who would persecute such a one. Someone who is standing up for God's truth, being persecuted, both exposes the one who is walking in the right and the one who is not. And that person will never have excuse. Once the curtain is lifted and they realize what they fully have done, there will be no stopping and saying, well, it's not fair that you're going to judge me for that. God is righteous in his judgments. And persecution provides that opportunity to make that clear. It's interesting that in verse 6, tribulation and trouble are actually the same root word. You know, in other words, God is bringing upon them a reaping of what they're sowing. It is perfectly just. Second thing, externally speaking, what are trials, and we'll close with this thought. Trials and persecutions and such, in terms of the external benefit or purpose, I should say, behind it, is that persecutions often add weight to our testimony. Again, we were at the Voice of the Martyrs conference yesterday, and there was this little Chinese woman who some years ago in China was dragged out of her home in the middle of the night. She'd been arrested a number of times for preaching the gospel. And one night, they didn't just arrest her. They actually brought her to a place where they beat her. And they showed a video of her replaying a reenactment of what she endured. And not even all of it. She explained some of it afterward that they didn't even show. But it was, you know, this big intimidating guy just, you know, they didn't, it was a movie, so they didn't really hit her. But you saw the bruises that were the marks that implied what had happened. But beyond that, they also pressed an electrified baton into her hands, put it into her mouth. Horrific things. Beat the bottoms and tops of her feet, where it made her march with these beaten, bloody feet across a concrete floor in shackles all night long, until she would sign a piece of paper denying her faith. It's hard to even talk about that. This little woman stood in front of this group of people, and she talked about that. And the part that moved everybody the most was in the midst of that, when she would cry out to God and say, why is this happening to me? She remembered the sufferings that he went through, and she didn't feel worthy of it. Suddenly her whole perspective changed. Well, you could hear a pin drop when she was talking about this. Why? Because that lady had cred. That lady had been through the ringer. That lady had experienced persecution. And I don't know who among her captors or her abusers may have come to faith through that. Maybe some did. But I'll tell you what, it changed me to hear that. and a lot of other people over the years that have heard her testimony. Nobody wants to go through trials and persecution. I mean, please don't think that this is intended to be a message of, you know, just toughen up and go look for those opportunities to be persecuted for Jesus. That's not what this is. It's not even a matter of trying to teach everybody to try and muster up the strength to just stand strong when they come. It's really just an intent to give some perspective to what they are. The church in the first century there in Thessalonica, they were a church under persecution. They were being oppressed. They were being afflicted. They were being harmed for nothing more than the fact that they followed Jesus. And they were able to endure it because they had it in perspective. They had confidence in the one that they had put their trust in. They had confidence in the Lord. And like Paul said, I am confident that what I have entrusted to him, he's able to keep until that day. It's that kind of a confidence that will allow you and I to face any of those obstacles, those persecutions, those trials and tribulations. And again, I don't believe in just saying cliche sounding things. And I'm not just saying it because it makes it sound like a great way to end a point on a message, but I truly do believe that the day is coming when it will be difficult to be a Christian in this country. And I don't think it's difficult right now. Some of you may think it is. And it may be in your life in some ways, but there will be a day coming when it will be difficult to be a Christian in this country. Are we going to cower and back up? Or is our confidence in the Lord going to carry us through that? Doran and I were just talking this morning. If the day comes where it becomes a crime to be a Christian, will there be enough evidence in our lives in that time to convict? Well, God help us. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your unchanging nature. We thank you for your consistency in our lives. We thank you that even when we go through trials and persecutions, you have infused those instances with meaning and purpose. The life of every one of your children counts to you. It matters to you. And you're investing in each one of us. Help us to avail ourselves, to be willing to understand that enough, to avail ourselves to that perspective when things get hard. We don't want to stick our spiritual chest out and say we can take it. We can't. But help us to lean on you, to press in as we seek to press on. We thank you for your grace toward us, Father. Lord, if there are any among us that don't know you, that maybe you've been touched by some of the things that your word has given to us today, then I pray that, Father, you would speak to their hearts right now. Help them to understand that the kind of courage and tenacity to press on in the face of opposition for the cause of Christ, for the person of Christ, may seem like a foreign thing to them. But maybe today they've begun to realize that you're the only one worth living for. If that's you, then I want to invite you to come, to lay down this old life you've been living, this life of sin, this life of self-centeredness, this life that has been pretty much just built around what you think is best for yourself. And instead come to Jesus, leaving that old life behind, leaving the sin behind, walking in the newness of life, knowing that your sins will be forgiven when you put your trust in him who paid for your sins on the cross, Jesus. I invite you to pray with me now if you're ready to do that. Heavenly Father, I come before you and I confess my sins to you, my wrongs, my transgressions, my sinfulness. I ask you to forgive me and to wash me clean. And Father, I ask you to help me to follow Jesus all of the days of my life, leaving behind the old life and walking with Jesus. And give me the confidence in you that wherever that path leads me, I will trust you and I will lean on you and I will know that you're working these things out for my good. Help me to be faithful as I walk out my days with you. Thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to take a few moments and enter into a time of sharing the Lord's Supper. I invite you as we sing and as we play to come up the middle aisles, row by row if you would, and then back around the sides to your seats with your cup and the bread. And then as we're singing and playing, I'll invite you to just take a moment to come before the Lord, confess those things this week that have maybe broken your fellowship with him, those things that you want to share with him, confess to him, and then partake as you will, and then we'll close our service after that. He died. Before you humbly, understanding our lack, our sinfulness, our wickedness, the depths of our hearts that are so far removed from you in our flesh. But Lord,
Those things not only remind us of how far we are from you, but they also remind us of your goodness and grace as we think about how Jesus came and paid for our sins on the cross, knowing us full well, better than we know ourselves, but he came anyway. Thank you for that. Thank you for setting us free, and thank you for the future and the hope that you've given us. We praise you and we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We'll just stand as we sing one last song together. You have a great week. Yeah.
Lord, I find you in the morning. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sin, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your things. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon.
Come, Lord Jesus, come.